All right, if you guys are, if everybody's done eating, I think that most folks are finished eating. We're gonna start the program. Again, my name's Adam Hinton. Thank you guys for being here with us today. I do want to take this opportunity to just briefly tell you guys about our family business. I'm fourth generation in the farm supply business. My great-grandfather started our business 100 years ago this year, so we are celebrating our centennial, and we'd love for you guys to come back throughout the year and celebrate with us as we have events. But the story of Hinton Mills starts a little bit before 1918, and some of you guys have heard this story, but I do want to share this for those of you who haven't and for Secretary Perdue. My great-grandfather that started our business when he was 9 years old, he unfortunately found himself as an orphan. Both his mother and his father had passed away, and because of which he only had a third grade education. His grandmother took him in, and his siblings, and he found himself as the man of the family. And the way that he got his start and kind of got our business starting was raising a baby calf. In fact, on our logo, you guys have probably seen, you were asking about this cow head. That represents that first baby calf that started our business. But my great-grandfather, the way the story goes, probably a neighbor, somebody that felt sorry for little orphan Frank, gave him a calf. He raised that calf and sold it, and he took that money. I'm sure he bought some groceries or necessities and bought another calf and took that calf, raised it, and sold it, and repeat. And next thing you know, he's raising two at a time or three at a time, and that's how we got started in our business. And then a few years later, let's fast forward to the 1950s when my papaw Hinton, when he got back from World War II, he joined the family business, and all he wanted to do was be a cattleman. And so he had a little farm, and he had cattle, and he would take care of his cattle after work and on the weekends. And so anyway, he realized it was inconvenient for him to have to go somewhere and get his feed ground, and so he decided maybe his neighbors might appreciate the opportunity to grind feed and mix feed close to home too. So that's how we got in the feed business. So if you fast forward to now, we've got five locations and 50 some just really amazing people on our team that service this part of the state. We sell feed, seed, fertilizer, fencing material, all the same stuff that a lot of the other folks in this room sell, or folks that in your community sell those same things. So at the end of the day, there's nothing we do that Senator Hornback and Representative Heath couldn't do right across the road from us. Please don't, but you could. But there's nothing we sell that's special or unique. What we do is we're a service business, a relationship business, and a logistic business. So if you scale that down a little further, we're a people business, and that's why all of you guys are here today. Agriculture is about people, and I want to highlight you know, a few people real quick. I do want to say how proud I am to be here to represent my brothers, Matt and Nathan, my dad, my mom, my cousin Donnie, and our team. So I thank you guys for the opportunity to let me get up and speak on behalf of us. And then I want to highlight one other person. You talk about service logistics relationships. Ronald Lawrence, our manager here at the Mays Lick store. He's been with us for 32 years. This is his first job off the dairy farm was here at Hinton Mills. And so when you guys think about relationships and logistics, if you do business with us and think about serving people, Ronald Lawrence would come to mind. So again, agriculture is about people, and I'm going to introduce one of those people, and then I'm going to sit down and let these guys talk. So the person that I'm going to introduce is a mentor to me. I don't know if he realizes that, but he's a mentor to a lot of people across the state of Kentucky. Mr. David Beck is with Kentucky Farm Bureau. Mr. Beck is from Lyon County, and he was a state FFA officer, which is near and dear to my heart. He's been with Farm Bureau since 1977, I believe, and has served in various capacities, including now as the executive vice president of Farm Bureau. And not only am I proud of how he advocates for agriculture across the state, but for me personally, I'm proud of what a fine Christian example that you are to me and to others. So I'm going to turn things over to Mr. David Beck.
Well, thank you. Thank you. Well, thank you very much, Adam, and thank you for the opportunity for Kentucky Farm Bureau to be a part of this event today and help with the meal and arrangements for it. Got several members of our board here, and if you're a board member of Farm Bureau, just raise your hand or stand if you would, please. We appreciate our board directors, our president, Mark Haney, Eddie Miller, our first vice president, could not be here today, but Mr. Giske, our second vice president, is, and he gave the invocation. We're so honored, Mr. Secretary, that you're here today in Kentucky. It's a special opportunity for our people to be able to chat with you, talk with you, ask you questions, and hear about some plans and things you have that will be affecting our industry. But I want to say first, though, how much we appreciate Adam and his family. Adam, you're a tremendous leader, not just in this community, but throughout Kentucky. And your family and what you do, the service you provide, the way you do it, the example of how to do agribusiness, how to do agriculture, how to be a leader of your community, how to give back. We appreciate that so much. Thank you for hosting us. Let's show our appreciation to the Hinton family. For what they do and how they do it, we appreciate them so much in so many, many different ways. You know, it is special to have the Secretary of Agriculture with us here today. Today's the first time I've had a chance to meet him personally, but I read a lot about him. And I'm just going to share a little story. Those of us in agriculture that watched the nomination process pretty closely, my good friend Zippy Duval could tell me a lot about you personally and his wife Bonnie, about you and Mary. And those of us in agriculture, I can say it's safe to say we had a good feeling of peace and comfort when you were named Secretary of Agriculture. Because we've got someone in that position that understands production agriculture. We got a man in that position that grew up on a dairy farm. He's been involved in agriculture. He's served the legislative process, been a two-term governor. He knows how it works. He understands the issue. As a licensed veterinarian, a man knows how to take care of livestock. He knows what's the right way to do it. Having people in that position to help lead our industry, lay the groundwork with the Congress and administration, and just think, we got a person sitting around the cabinet table that's been there, understands production agriculture. Mr. Secretary, we appreciate that so much for what you do. I've been asked to mention two or three issues, and then after that, I want to introduce our Commissioner of Agriculture state level. Some things that we don't expect you to answer now, but maybe think about during the Q&A, maybe you could shed some light on some of these topics. We all know we're getting ready to deal with the Farm Bill. The hearings process are been going on. We've had working groups here in Kentucky for many months working on the Farm Bill. It's important to all of us. Even those not production agriculture depend heavily on this Farm Bill. It's important to Kentucky's economy. And we respect that, we know that, and we got to have the right legislation at the end of the day. Some of the things that come to mind that are on the agenda, I mentioned dairy. And that's a tough issue. I know you come from a dairy farm. Just a few weeks ago, we had over 100 dairy farmers in this region of our country. They got a letter that says, end of May, we're not going to take your milk anymore. Now, folks, that's hard. That's tough. And I've tried to explain that to some of my city neighbors, what that means. It's like walking out of that plant in the afternoon at shift change, and you get an envelope. We don't need you after May. But in addition to not having a job, look at the investment. You got to liquidate your herd, your investment. What's your family going to do? That's devastating to farm families. And I know we've talked about it a few years, and we've been a part of that public policy process, but we've got to talk about what we're going to do the future of dairy in this industry, in this country, from the pricing, from production and cost, transportation, all that. In Louisville, Kentucky, where I live, I took a snapshot and shared it on Facebook this weekend. Milk was 78 cents a gallon. It'll be chocolate, whole milk, or 2%, 78 cents a gallon. And I can't find anything else I can buy a gallon of for 78 cents. That's what we're dealing with out there. Hopefully that some attention be given to that and we can see some short-term answers, but long-term answers in this Farm Bill. I see Hilda Legg here with Rural Development, our director. Rural Development is important to all of us. Broadband, what can we expect with the internet service? Those of us in Nashville during the American Farm Bureau annual meeting back in January when you were there along with the president, we were so appreciative to see the executive order signed. Laying the groundwork to do more for infrastructure. We need that in Kentucky. We need wise decisions being made around infrastructure. I want to mention broadband. I know we have members of the General Assembly here, and they talk about it. It's a priority for them. In rural Kentucky, we're behind, and we're losing ground every day on not having broadband service. Now, think about it from an educational standpoint. We have young kids that have to go back to town at night to a fast food restaurant to do the homework. Just to be able to get internet service. That's one component of this. Another component of those is in agribusiness, like this facility here. You gotta be able to take that plastic card. You gotta be able to deal with internet and promotion and access. Our farm markets, our farmers, own operations. Broadband's important. Now, Secretary, we welcome hearing any thoughts you would have of what we can do, what USDA can do through rural development, other areas, to help us bridge that gap. As a society and an economy, as we depend more and more on technology. We're going behind. We're losing ground fast. We're getting further behind as we try to deal with this issue. So I just want to mention that as one that's important to us. Another one is water. I want to talk about water. We all have seen the numbers and what's going to happen in 2050 and how many more people we got to feed in this country. And with less land, less chemicals, less labor, and sometimes less water. Water is a critical issue. It is for agriculture, but it's also for economic development. Think about water for a minute. A state like ours, we get plenty of rainfall. Problem is, we don't get it at the right time. You can pretty much count on it every year in Kentucky, we're going to go from a drought to a flood. We don't know which part of the state, but one of us will get too much rain, and some of us will get not enough. We have that every year we're dealing with. I'm very proud that in Kentucky, our legislature took action. Our GOEP office, Governor's Office of Ag Policy, is working with us, helping with us, our Natural Resources Cabinet, our governor. We're trying to deal with how we can do a better job of capturing that water and having it to reduce our costs on the farm for our crops, but also for our livestock. But it's an economic development issue as well. And also talk about how we deal with that with the cities. We don't need farmers and city folks fighting over the water. We all be able to capture that water for everybody's benefits. I know Karen with our NRCS is here. Your office is working. We appreciate that, our state conservationists. Water's an issue, and we'll be looking with USDA too. What can we do to help us do a better job? Maybe to loosen the rules so NRS can be more helpful to us, give us the right advice to move forward and deal with water issues. I want to mention trade. We had an opportunity earlier this week, some of us did, to talk with Leader McConnell about trade. We know it's a major issue. We depend heavily on trade in agriculture. We've got to have it. Over a third of our grain produced here in Kentucky goes overseas. But poultry, beef, pork, same thing, Commissioner. That's what we're dealing with. It's important. Farm income, the bottom line, is heavily dependent in this state on what we're going to deal with. It comes down to trade. We realize that's an issue for the administration. We appreciate you being there, working to help us in NAFTA and trade agreements and things. It's very important. So, Mr. Secretary, I just want to mention those issues. You've got Undersecretary McKinney. Thank you for making that appointment. We think he'll be a tremendous asset to you and your team as you work on these trade issues. We want you to know Kentucky depends heavily on trade. We do today, and we're going to do more so tomorrow. So it's very important. So I just want to share those topics with you. I know others will have things here they want to bring up too later on during the Q&A, but I want to get those in front of you today, if I may. Now it's my opportunity, my privilege, to introduce what I consider a good friend, our Commissioner of Agriculture, Commissioner Ryan Quarles. He was elected to that seat in 2015. It seems like a lot longer than that with all he's been doing. A tremendous staff. They've been doing some good things. The Hunger Initiative, finally breaking through, dealing with the tough issue to help folks reduce that 6% in Kentucky and deal with that food situation. Trade, I mentioned it a while ago, your work in China on equine going to be beneficial to the state and have a domino effect for lots of industries. I know you're leading a group to Canada this summer. We appreciate the effort there to try to strengthen those relationships. This man wants to serve agriculture. He's been working to bring about new markets. But I'm not surprised with that. You're not either. I've kind of watched him grow up in our organization, in FFA and 4-H, and I know he's a leader, and you do as well. He was elected to the General Assembly, and when he was in the General Assembly, he served three terms. He represented Scott County and Owen County, and he represented parts of Fayette County. And as I think back, he served on the Ag Committee, when he served on Banking Insurance and other committees, he was always asking, what can I do to help agriculture? What can I help to do for rural Kentucky? And he wasn't doing it for the headline. He wasn't doing it for the fanfare. He was wanting to know what he could do behind the scenes to make it. Commissioner, we appreciate that leadership and that example you provide. Please join me in welcoming to today's program our Commissioner of Agriculture.
and advocate for agriculture in general to the president, to the White House, to the staff there. And then I also think it's my responsibility, vice versa, to represent him and his policies and his thoughts and his decisions back to the ag community. So that's why we're here, to have a bilateral conversation of what's on your mind and what we can do. And with that in mind, I'd like to hush, and we're going to ask the commissioner, I guess, to either moderate. I find that you don't really need to be too inviting when you want to know what's on farmers' minds. Most of the time, they'll tell you. So if you ask, they'll tell you. Sometimes, commissioner, if you don't ask, they'll tell you.
Right.
So we look forward to hearing from you and would welcome any kind. No questions are off the table. If they're uncomfortable, then ask them anyway, and we'll be uncomfortable together. Okay?
Larry.
Secretary, glad to have you here.
Yes.
Really honored. I serve as the president of the Kentucky Soybean Association. So with these new tariff talks, really scary to the farmers in Kentucky and where they could lead. I want to know what your thoughts are on that, what your discussion has been, and the president is going to protect agriculture from the trade war. So how does he come to the world?
Sure. Told me that as recently as night before last. He said, Sonny, know you're on the road in Michigan, Ohio, Kentucky, and I want you to tell the farmers that we're not going to let them be the casualties in any kind of trade disputes. Now, obviously, it's not probably very smart in these kind of things to lay all your cards on the table about what you're going to do, but he's authorized me already to use the authorities we have within the current appropriations, the Commodity Credit Corporation and others, to develop a plan once we see what the impact of these tariffs will be. My advocacy to him is that, Mr. President, I think you've got their attention. Now let's get to the table and resolve this, because the two major economies in the world both only get hurt when you start having trade disputes. Now, I want to say very loudly, clearly, and proudly that I'm proud of President Trump for calling China's hands. They hadn't played by the rules. Joined the WTO in early, cheated ever since, and they are over in agriculture. Have you heard the story about them going out in the field and picking up corn seed and trying to reverse engineer the genetics of corn seed here? So they've stolen and they've imposed intellectual property transfer for companies that want to do business over there. So I'm proud to serve a man that will call it on the, you know, call on the line and put us at some risk to say we're not going to keep on tolerating your cheating. Now, that he understands there may be some temporary pain, and I've told him, farmers and some of the best patriots I know, they serve their country, and they till this soil, they provide a national security through food security, and they're willing to do their part. They don't want to be sacrificing alone, by the way, and he understands that, and that's the message he's told me, is that you tell them that we're not going to let them be the only casualty in this battle here. There. So I bring that message to you. I would love to be more specific about some of the things we've been talking about for weeks and months about a modeling if this comes about, but we need to reserve those kind of details for later on when we implement them, because I don't think we ought to, as a nation, ought to show all our cards at one time. So I don't know what kind of relief that is. There's a legitimate anxiety. I frankly was pleasantly surprised that the markets haven't been hit as hard as they have, honestly. Now, the good news about it, these are saber rattlings. The tariffs haven't started yet. Hopefully it's a warning to one another that, you know, if you don't do this, then we're going to do that. We got 30 to 60 days to start sitting down and negotiating, and that's what we're encouraging the president and his team. You got their attention now. Let's get down to business and negotiate the things that are meaningful. But that's kind of where we are.
From the county next door, Fleming County. I'm a cow-calf producer, along with most everybody else in the room. As you know, Kentucky is the largest beef producing state east of the Mississippi River. Was in the dairy business, just like, you know, they're talking about. I have gotten some of those letters, you know, in the past. And I know some of those letters went out when they said, we're not going to buy your milk anymore. I know some of those letters went out with a suicide hotline number. I have gotten some of those letters. I know they're legitimate. Mm-hmm. Long time ago. I wish I'd have kept one. not that they were not buying the milk anymore, just that the milk prices were so depressed. Now that I'm in the beef industry, what I'm concerned about now, not only just is trade, but this clean meat movement.
Happened when the rice guys came in, and they were concerned about some of these products like cauliflower being called cauliflower rice or something like that. I'd never seen the products, but some other things other than rice grain being used and called rice. And I said, man, that's terrible. I can't believe they'd do that. Is that kind of like rice milk? And they didn't say a lot after that. But your point's well taken, obviously, and while we got a lot of technological challenges, I'm still not convinced that the American consumer is going to prefer that. But from a labeling perspective, we need to make sure that it's not come, you know, a definitive difference between animal protein and petri dish meat, if you want to call it that. So we'll be looking at that. We don't probably, we're ways away, I think, from any kind of commercial products on that, but we'll try to stay ahead of that curve. Is a good point you made.
Yeah, I feel like I feel the same way. You know, a lot of people won't eat white bread anymore. Yeah. So I'm like, I'm not so sure that you're going to eat, clean meat or whatever you want to label it. But I also don't want to sleep on the issue and then one day half the meat cakes is taken up with,
sure,
you know, whatever they want.
Well, obviously, Adam said he'd been in the marketing business. Marketers are very clever. If you market something as, quote, clean meat, what's the implication? You know, that others is not clean. We've seen a little bit of that, and we have some struggle in our organic community. Organic industry's done well, but early on in their marketing, the implication was we're organic, we're purer, we're better, we're more wholesome, and all that, and disparaging that. That's one, I don't know if the press is here now, that's one reason I don't eat at Chipotle's now, because they disparage the American farmer. And I won't put up with that, won't go in there. So,
Terry?
Thank you for coming, Mr. Secretary. I'm Terry Rowley. So I would hope that somewhere along the line that some of the Farm Bill talks, some of the nutrition aspects of it, you will encourage a higher butterfat content of milk to be put into the school food programs and all, and to help us out in that nature. And we all pray every day that tomorrow we'll look on the internet and see that milk price futures has gone up some, so that we can continue to survive instead of erode our equity in our farming operations.
Good point. Let me address the second one first, then we'll go back to the MPP program and the Farm Bill. One of the first things I did, after being confirmed, we went out to a school in Virginia there and announced that we were going to give a waiver on the regulations that flavored milk of 1% would be allowed back into schools. That was a huge change. What we saw with the school nutrition guidelines that were put out in the former administration, we saw the trash can grow and the consumption lessen with the usability of food. It can't be nutritious if you're throwing it away and stopping by the convenience store or the fast food store on the way home and filling, getting your calories that way. So that's one of the things we did. G.T. Thompson, a member of Congress, has a bill. We've gone about as far as we can regulatory-wise. He's got a bill statutorily that would go to the 2% level again in school nutritions, and we would like to see that passed. It possibly can become part of the Farm Bill. There has been some discussion of being in the Farm Bill, which is where it needs to be. Within the agency, you can do a few things regulation-wide, and we did that. We slowed down the salt limitation area going forward, and we stopped the requirement over 100% whole grain. There were three actions that we took. Those were the initial regulatory actions that we sent a signal to the school nutrition professionals that we wanted them to manage the school lunches, not prescription from the high. And we want to be healthy, we want to be wholesome, but we want to be tasty as well, so kids will drink it. And you put flavored skim milk out there, and you know what kids are going to do with it. Thank you for mentioning the margin protection program. We actually did do that. That was Congress's solution to something they realized had not been effective in the 14 Farm Bill. The limits there were not helpful. It was very little utilization. That's why last fall we allowed dairymen to get out of even the basic program, because it had not been effective in that way, and many of them did. I think at this level, it will be helpful, and I hope that for the smaller dairies up to that 5 million pounds of milk, it will begin next week over the market about the constraints that need to be done in this world.
Out in Hopkinsville, Kentucky. So just sort of your thoughts on that what kind of input you've got on that process, because it affects agriculture, but it's really put in place by EPA.
Right. The RFS program has been very helpful, obviously, for agriculture in general, but for corn producers primarily. Scott Pruitt, the EPA administrator, I have a really good relationship. He's kind of in the barrel over some media issues right now, but we've had good relationships. I have an inquiry in him right now over these waivers, particularly this latest either rumor or actual waiver of the larger company in one of their smaller refineries. He followed the president's direction. The president's been strong on this over the 15 million gallon RVO obligation there. I hope he's not trying to circumvent that with waivers initially. We were very disappointed in the bankruptcy case in Pennsylvania where EPA agreed to let them out of about, 300 million gallons or something like that. And then this other one, along with the There have been waivers, and there were the statute provided for waivers over small merchant refineries that didn't have the opportunity to blend like maybe some of the larger ones had. The one company that had about 7 or 8, I think, refineries there and got a big exemption for some of that, I've asked them a question. We're going to have a direct conversation on it. The president talked to me Monday night about overall RFS issue and asked me if I would guide that to a conclusion based on where we are. Our goal is really to get the RVP of 15%, where the E15 can be sold year-round, which will grow that revision. We have some ideas about how to do that, the petroleum people haven't been interested unless they could get some other considerations over RIN prices, which is understandable in some ways, but it's a good question, and I don't have the answer right now about how much volume of that $15 billion has been eroded with waivers. EPA, I think, has taken the position they don't have to announce that, but I'm pretty sure that Scott will tell me if we ask him, and I'm going to really impress upon him the fact that it's not going to be in his best interest if he goes around $15 billion by issuing waivers overall. So, good question. Thank you.
I wanted to say I'm Mari Cox from the Kentucky Dairy Development Council, and I got some inside scoop from some Georgia milk producers on you, and they said you really did like chocolate milk. We just mentioned that.
Right.
And so I've got some milk and ice cold milk and some cheese in here.
Can you pass it up? Thank you, sir.
There you go. Thank you. Two things on that, though. I figured to get rid of a little bit of surplus, you take it with you. The second thing,
can you
you could drink it here and you could drink it on the road. I was told that it couldn't be a gift over $25 in the present milk prices. I appreciate your comments on about the dairy, and I know you're connected with that, and I know we may have some difficulty in getting the MPP implemented with some producers because of their experience, but we're going to do everything we can to try to promote that and find a safety net.
Very good. Thank you. I had one of these 2 days ago, so I might have another.
Mr. Secretary, I've got a question about farm bill. Just to give you a visualization here, raise your hand if you've ever worked or grown tobacco in your life. Just look at this. Now, if you're working in tobacco in 2018, keep your hand raised. So you can just see that there's a bad effect there. Over the past 15 years, we've been lucky the governor's office backed policy to re-diversify a set of master settlement agreement monies to really diversify Kentucky. But one of the byproducts of that diversification is sometimes Kentucky's in a unique position when it comes to crop insurance. So like a lot of our farmers in this part of the state not been growing grain as long as others. And so sometimes there's misalignment when it comes to ARC and TLC. And I was just wanting to know, I was curious what your thoughts are about the future of crop insurance. And then secondly, during a period of stagnant commodity prices, we're trying to grow our markets internationally. And the MAP funding, market access funding program, is so important for us. And I know there's a push to maybe double that in the next farm bill. I was curious what your thoughts were about crop insurance and also MAP funding.
I think crop insurance is in safe hands. The chairman of the Senate Ag Committee, Pat Roberts from Kansas, kind of views himself as the father of crop insurance. So I think it's safe. The challenge will be probably more so in the specialty crops, how we make them actuarially sound. We saw some challenges, certainly in the citrus and the pecan issue with hurricanes this year. The other thing from the former tobacco growers and is really on the farm bill is how do you develop base, and then what is the base left? We know in the buyout, we obviously from Georgia had the tobacco growers as well as peanut growers. And both those programs went away and the base was eliminated. But how do you, what is the reasonable way to allow these growers who used to be tobacco growers in order to build and accumulate base for the last few years? So that's been kind of stagnant. So I'm hoping the Farm Bill will address a modern history crop production that will allow them to qualify under annual production history in that way. The MAP program typically is helpful. I'm a skin in the game kind of guy. Don't think you ought to depend on the federal government to do all your marketing for you, but for people who will assess themselves through checkoffs and others, we want to be there as a real partner nationwide, internationally, frankly, to help develop markets, help increase markets. You know, with the challenge we have with China currently and maybe some others, that we got to open new markets. We barely touched India. It's a very difficult place to do business with. Ted McKinney, our Undersecretary of Trade, has been there twice, and we continue knocking on that door. Mm-hmm. And then that's the way you develop markets, and that's what we've told the President about the China situation. You develop markets, and you know, Adam and your family knows, you kind of tell a customer you're not going to serve him for a while, or you can't get to him, and you lose him. It takes a long time to get him back. That's what happens in trade there as well. So we need to be trying to open markets every door, and that's what every day, and that's what that MAP money's for.
We'll get the signal for one more question, I believe.
Two more questions.
I am Warren Mingler with the Governor's Office of Ag Policy. We in Kentucky have been so fortunate with this tobacco settlement, take half of it and put it in agriculture. Do a lot of four governors and all these legislators understand we've now invested $560 million in agriculture and grown agriculture on a low market from $3.7 billion to $5.7 billion, $2 billion in 15 years. We, Senator Hornback talked about the Coppinsville elevator. Mark Haney, the head of Farm Bureau, said we just keep growing corn and beans and piling up big piles and breaking even and think we're doing good. The two growth areas we see are export, and that you never know what that's going to be, and value added. Coppinsville elevator this year gave back to their farmers 4,000 farmers, 61 counties, $39,518,000. You have all you see everywhere. We've got this money. We want this money to be so impactful for farmers, help farmers help themselves, but at the same time to try to grow agriculture that it can be more profitable, get a little bigger piece of pie. What do you see out there in ways that we could take this little bit of money we've got and make it better for Kentucky Ag?
Well, actually, sir, with the growth that you talk about, you ought to be telling me. That's what rural development's all about, and the aspect of coming into rural communities. You've mentioned one of those things, and it is value added. I mean, again, y'all do a pretty good job in these barrels here in Kentucky. mash turns into something people pay for. But we got to do better than adding other products and developing those things. Kentucky, I think, has been pretty good in some of the value added things. How do we further process? And really, what we see in the international market is people love USDA products. And it's only the restrictions that their government keep out from a protectionist system that we're unable to sell more, whether it's EU or Southeast Asia. So we need to be really aggressive about investing in value-added products, further processing. First of all, it creates manufacturing jobs. It's good for producers with a better value. And these farmers have got these letters. If there was something we could do, from a dairy perspective, a dairy co-op or something here to make cheese or cream or whatever, that kind of thing. That's part of what USDA is also, wants to help in. A realistic idea, good business model plan, well underwritten to be able to help from a rural development standpoint. We'd love to team up with states like Kentucky to have money where we can do a triangulation of private equity, state funding, USDA, to make 1 + 1 + 1 equal more than 3. One more question back here.
Yeah, my name's Charlie Maskins. My wife and I have a little beef cattle farm over in Fleming County. And we're kind of filling in the hole that we used to have from tobacco by value-added selling beef directly to the consumer. And the commissioner has done a great job in formulating farmers markets, which gives us a marketing venue for our beef. And with the USDA, there's a program for where the seniors are, certain seniors are given vouchers to buy food at farmers markets. But the food has got to be fruits and vegetables and herbs and honey, but it excludes protein, excludes meat. And while you two are here, it seems like something that a signature could probably.
You just do what kind of mother may I environment I operate in. You understand that I can get that done in about 10 years. That's part of, probably part of the farm bill, though, really, that is another idea we can take back.
Let's show the Secretary appreciation.
Gifts for you. I know you're a milk guy, but here in Kentucky we have LA1. Do not drink this before bed. A lot of caffeine. Great signature Kentucky product. And also for you to share on the bus are some bourbon balls. And the best thing about bourbon balls is that if anyone gives you a hard time about it, you can eat the evidence. Enjoy.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Mr. Secretary, it's been a pleasure to be with you today. Wife Mary, your team, and it's good to see our friend of the Beth and back. Many years ago, she was the Farm Bureau team. Thank you for mentioning that, and you're taking good care of her. I think she's taking good care of you. So, Kentucky's got connected all around. Part of what you're doing in agriculture is being a master. You understand that you're telling the story. And just to share an example, one of the things we're doing here in Kentucky, Kentucky Farm Bureau commissioned a book this past year, and it's a wonderful dream. It's a story about a young boy here in Kentucky and his love for agriculture. And kind of walks through his daily life and how he connects to agriculture. Since last fall, we've had over 5,000 of these books placed in different classrooms around the country. In fact, the day as I was driving here, one of our women chairmen was on the phone talking to me about she was so disappointed. This is spring break, but she had the week off of being in the classroom reading this book to children. To me, that's a great example of volunteers helping tell the story of agriculture. Secretary, thank you so much for being here. Thank you for leadership. Thank you for what you do. The Kentucky Farm Bureau, we want to give you this. But hope you and Mary and your grandchildren would enjoy this.
Thank you very much.
We got one more gift for you, but before we give you that, we just want to both publicly thank you for attending, your staff for being here in the USDA. We want to thank Commissioner Quarles, the Kentucky Department of Agriculture, for being a part of this. And for Kentucky Farm Bureau and Mr. Beck for co-hosting this event with us here today. Also want to give a quick shout out to RFD-TV for helping with this event. And most importantly, we want to thank everyone in the room for taking time out of your busy schedule to be here to support Kentucky agriculture. So we've got a gift from the Hinton family. There's only one other of these that exist outside of one of our buildings, and Commissioner Quarles has the others. So this is it's a replica of an old feed bag, burlap bag, that we'd be honored if you would hang that somewhere, or if Miss Mary wants to hang that somewhere. But we'd like to send that with you, and thank you so much for all that you are doing for agriculture across our state, but also across the U.S.
Thank you, Adam. He called this burlap. In Georgia, we call it something else. Y'all ever heard of a croaker sack? We had a state senator, Mr. Chairman, that said we were down in South Georgia talking about broadband, David, there, and he said, we got folks in Atlanta in the legislature don't know a croaker sack from a cul-de-sac.
Yes, Mr. Secretary, explain to us why it's Houston County.
Okay, it's the name after a governor, and his name was pronounced Houston. I always love the fact when our company was named Houston Fertilizer and Grain, and I'd call out to Texas, talking to some people business-wise, and they said, how do you spell that? I said, well, it's pretty simple. It's spelled just like Houston, Texas.
we have one more gift that showed up on behalf of Sam Johnson, one of our state FFA officers here today, and he's got a gift on behalf of the Kentucky FFA Foundation. Again, we want to thank all of you guys for coming. I'd like to thank the Secretary. You're welcome to stay as long as you'd like. We're open for business. Stay and visit. We appreciate it.